Hi students, today we are going to see about normalization, that is the unit 2. We are going to see what is meant by normalization, how normalization is done.
To start with, let us see what is meant by normalization, that is what is meant by the definition of normalization. Normalization is nothing but a process of designing database. That is, when we get any raw data, that is raw information, these are stored, you know, in as they have come. So there is no particular order in how they are being stored. So when we are creating a database to store this particular data, so we have to do some kind of filtering of data, some kind of stretching of data where to store. So this is how we are going to see how to design a database. So why we should do this? Normalization is done mainly to avoid redundancy, that is the data redundancy and data anomalies. So what is meant by data redundancy? So data redundancy means, you know, repeated data, repeated information being displayed everywhere. So what will happen if there is a repeated data everywhere? Supposing a repeated information is displayed in many places, no, unnecessary information is being transmitted number of times, and this will reduce the efficiency of data being displayed on the screen or on the application which we are using. So for that reason, the database, the basic purpose of designing a database should be to avoid any data redundancy. And anomalies are the mistakes that are done when we are inserting, updating or deleting data. You know, when we are adding some data, suppose you are inserting some information about student into a database, you know, at that point, if there are many number of files where you need to update this student information, see, there could be a problem or a mistake, a human error could occur when inserting different tables. So we should avoid that. So that should be avoided, that kind of thing. We should take care when we are designing the database itself, so that, you know, this kind of repeated data is there. So we can avoid that when we are inserting the database. So before we start with inserting, we have to, you know, design the database, how it has to be. So that, you know, with designing of a database is called as normalization, and the purpose of normalization is to avoid data redundancy and anomalies. And next, what is the process? How do we do a database design or normalization? So there are different, you know, steps or stages in which this is done. So the series of stages are followed before designing a particular database. So there are, what are the steps? Majorly we can see first normalization, no, second normalization, on third, and fourth one is also called as Boyce-Codd normal form, and fifth normal form is also there. So many companies, you know, when they are designing their database, they generally follow the 1, 2 and 3, and also BCNF, and occasionally very few companies follow 5NF, which is very extensive normalizing of the data. So now let us see what are the basic rules when we are designing a first normal form. So first thing, when you are designing for the data, you know, we are having different stages, right? So when we are designing a database, when we are talking about the first normal form, so the data should be collected, that is, you know, in this form. In this form, the different data will be collected. Like here, if you see, there are some blank records, you know, where there is no particular value. So these are not actually any values are there. They are called as null values. So some things, all these things, you know, there are certain mistakes, you know. So these nulls should not be there. And, you know, sometimes we are repeating certain kind of information. Even here, there is a null. So all these kind of things should be taken care of. So what are the things that we should follow? What are the rules? So the first thing is values are atomic. That is, you know, they should not be repeated. Repeating values should be removed. If suppose this particular record, like Geeta's record is coming, it can come for two times. If suppose she has, again by mistake, or for example, she has paid another fees. So another new record will be added for Geeta. So a repetitive values will be there on the Geeta's record. So that should be avoided. And next one is eliminate null values. As it is, you can see this is not a defined, I mean, it's not a structure which is normalized. This is a raw. So from this one, we will start doing a normalization. First thing is, any repeating values are there, you have to eliminate them. And then we should eliminate null values. All these null values should be filled up with this. For example, here it is BCom Computers. So another one is null. So this null will be replaced by BCom Computers. And here also all these null values should be replaced with the appropriate values. Even here, see here I have written it as second year. So even Sita is also in second year, so that is why it is left as null. So here itself we are going to write again as second year. And then we are going to identify the primary key. I told you what is meant by primary key. A key uniquely identifies every record. Every record is identified by a unique key. See, for example, this student ID. So student ID is unique. So there is a 001. This ID is not repeated anywhere else. So this student ID becomes a primary key. So first thing, you are going to identify the primary key also. Next one is a dependent attribute for the primary key. So what are the dependent attributes of the primary key? So is the course ID dependent on student ID? Is it dependent? No, it is not dependent. Is the course name dependent on course ID? Yes, very much. It is dependent. And name is the student name dependent on course name? No. So we are going to do like this a dependency test. What to identify what are the attributes or columns which are dependent on the primary key. So after, I'll show you after doing the first normal form, how this table is going to look. So here you can see this is how the data will look like. You know, all the repeating null values have been removed. Earlier there were null values here and here. They have been removed here. We have added all those data appropriately to the columns. So this is the first normal form. So now the table is called as having passed the first normal form. So now we have completed the first normal form and entering into the second normal form. In order to enter into the second normal form, we should have completed the first normal form should be completed. Now we are coming to the second normal form. So in the second normal form, we are going to do decomposing of the different tables. By how we are going to do is, we are going to check the dependencies of the different attributes on the various keys that are available. On the primary key especially. So we are going to do a dependency, decomposing of the whole table into different columns. And also we are going to assign primary key, that is the key attributes, which we call as a primary key, to every table that we are going to create. And this every table, the table we are going to decompose, will have the dependent attributes as their columns in that particular entities or tables. So let us come back to our example here. We have taken the course. I mean, this complete entire thing was one table earlier. And now we have, we are checking what are the columns which are dependent. So if we see course ID and course, course name is all ultimately like the course ID is related. I mean, they are dependent on the course ID, and course ID will be unique. So that is why, so we are able to identify, this is something which we can decompose. We can separate it from this particular entire table. We need not repeat that particular values we are repeating here, right? We need not repeat this. These are repeated values or which we can identify as being a separate entity. Okay, now let us see this particular thing, the student ID. The student ID, student name and the year he is studying, marks and the fee that they have paid. So we can see that the student name is again dependent on student ID, and as well as the year, marks and other attributes. These are all are dependent on student ID. We can separate this as a different entity. So now we have this particular diagram. We call this as dependency diagram. We draw this diagram in what? In the second normal form, we are going to draw a dependency diagram. And now we are going to see what are the partial dependencies. We have to first identify the partial dependencies. That is, we are going to see here the course ID and the course name. That's what I told you. So this name of the course is dependent on the course ID. So I'm going to separate this and put it like this. No course ID, point and our draw an arrow or a pointer and put it as course name. And we have the student ID and the pointers are student name and other attributes. So step one, again, you know, we are going to see the step one. First thing is identify the key attributes or the key components. So we have identified what are the key components. You can see that the course ID is one of the key component. Student ID is a component. And then we can have the course ID and student ID both together. They form one relation. You know, they form one entity. And we can call that as enroll entity. So a new table is being again formed. Why? Because these marks, you know, here, the marks are not dependent on the student name. So we are going to separate this to another table called as enroll. So let us see, you know, what we are going to do in the step two. In step two, we are going to mainly do two tasks. One is like, you know, we are going to do a relationship schema and a dependency diagram. So this is primarily I'm doing it for only the course table. Likewise, we have to do for the student table and also for the enroll table. So here I'm going to identify that. What is this? This is the course ID. It is the primary key and course name is a dependent attribute or a column. So we are going to do a relation schema just like this. You know, you have to write course and open a bracket and then write the primary key. And then write the dependent attribute like this. So we have to draw a relation schema and then we have to draw a dependency diagram. So this is how your dependency diagram should look like. And we have to do a similar kind of thing for the student table as well as and also for the enroll table. So this concludes our what? Second normal form. After completion the second normal form, let us see about the third normal form and what are the steps we have to do in order to complete this third normal form. So here the first, in order to come to the third normal form, we should have completed the second normal form. And what are the steps involved? So the first one is identifying the transitive dependencies. So, for example, in the earlier, the relation we have seen here, we could see that the student name, ID, you know, year, marks, fee. So, here these two are dependent, rather this year and marks are not dependent on the student ID. So, now these are the transitive dependencies. So, we are going to separate them and we are going to put them in as a identified as a different transitive dependencies. So next, what we have to do is identify to whom these transitive dependent IDs are dependent on. So for example, how much fee we have to pay, a student has to pay, might depend on the student year he is studying. So we are going to put this as a different entity here. Okay, so the fee amount is actually dependent on the student year. So after removing the attributes, it could be like a student ID and only the student name, or it could be along with the year he or she is studying.
And another new entity is the fees, which will contain the student ID, year and the amount. So this is a new entity, because after doing the third normal form where we have identified the transitive dependency columns, after that we are going to decompose and form another table called as fees. So now we have got as, now what are the new tables that we have are the course, student, fees, and we have enrolled. Let us once look into this course table. So course table has the course ID and the course name. So these are, what are these called as? These are the dependency diagram. When you are writing about it, you know, in your answer, in your exams, so you have to draw the dependency diagram as well as the schema diagram. You know, you have to draw even the schema also. As we have discussed earlier, you know how the schema is like this. So you have to write the schema also, relationship schema. So here, if you see, so we have the course ID. And course name is dependent on course ID. Course ID is the primary key. And here the student name, student ID, and student name and year are dependent on student ID. And if you take this as a fees amount, there are no fees table. So we have the student ID, year, and the amount that the particular student has paid. You know, every year we are going to see how much fees. So next, enroll. So we have, for enroll, we have composite columns, that is course ID and student ID. And see, date of joining depends on both of these two columns. These two columns uniquely identify the particular student enrollment. So this concludes our third normalization form.
So now we have completed the three normal forms. So you take an example as a homework. Like, you know, for example, an employee, or it could be a billing, you know, when we go to your department shop, the billing receipt and everything, the product, or it could be a sales department, how it, take any other scenario, do it as an exercise, as a homework for you to, you know, do the understand actually what are the different stages in a normalization form. And if you have any questions, keep me prepared. Tomorrow's session, I will answer all those questions or doubts that you have.